All right, let's solve a triangle where we're given all three side lengths. So A, B, and C are given to us. I've gone ahead and drawn just kind of an ambiguous triangle going on here. Definitely not drawn to scale at all, but I like having a visual in front of me as I'm working through these types of problems. So we label them as A's are across from each other, B's and C's opposite. All right, so in getting going on this, we don't have an opposite pair, like both the A's or both the B's or both the C's. So we can't use law of sines, and we definitely don't know that this is a right triangle, so we can't use any of our trigonometric ratios. So we're kind of limited to law of cosines. So we can start out wherever we want as we get going on this, but I'm gonna choose to just start with A. So in doing this, this is like the alpha in the formula over on the right-hand side, that it's going to be whatever is opposite side A. So I'm going to use the top version of our law of cosines over here. So I'm going to go ahead and say 40 squared is going to equal B squared, which is 70 squared, plus C squared, 106 squared, minus 2 times B times C, multiplied by the cosine. In our case, I'm going to call it A. All right, and then we've plugged into the formula. The only unknown is this cosine of A. So we've got a bunch of constants. Let's work out what these constants basically work out to in our calculator. So this would be 1600 equals 4900 plus 106 squared is 11,236. Kind of big numbers, use the calculator. 14,840 multiplied by the cosine of A. All right, so next up, we're still working on isolating the cosine of A. I'm gonna go ahead and subtract this 4,900 and subtract this 11,236, move it over to the left-hand side and isolate this term. Don't move this over just yet. So in subtracting those two constants, I got negative 14,536 is equal to the negative 14,840 cosine of A. All right, these are attached with multiplication, so you can't go and add this to move it to the other side. That's where a lot of the mistakes happen on this type of example with the law of cosines. So to get this to the other side and isolate the cosine of A, we're gonna have to divide both sides by that negative 14,840. That creates a one and gets the cosine of A on one side all by itself. I'm not doing any simplifying here besides getting rid of the double negatives, right? One in the numerator, one in the denominator. This would reduce down further, but we're gonna get our calculators out and get those to help us in just a second anyway. So to finish this up and find angle A, we're gonna apply a cosine inverse on both sides. So cosine inverse of, again, this fraction, just copying down the same thing, is going to be the cosine inverse of cosine of A. Function and its inverse are going to reduce down. Just giving us A over here. Then we'll punch this into our calculator. If we want it in degrees, we have to be in degree mode in our calculator, of course. But I'm going to get A is going to be 11.6 degrees. All right, so 11.6 degrees, just kind of filling in. I like putting it into the triangle to remind myself what I'm missing in the triangle. All right, from here, we still need to find angle B and angle C. We could definitely set up using the law of cosines, one of these other versions as we go through and do that. At this point, we do have an opposite side length and the opposite angle. So I'm gonna elect to go to the law of sines. Okay, so setting this up, let's try to find angle C because we have side length C. So with law of sines, I would set that up as sine of C divided by the side length C is equal to sine of angle A, sine of 11.6 degrees divided by 40. All right, in solving this down, it shouldn't be too bad. We're gonna initially get rid of this 106. We're gonna move it to the other side by multiplying both sides by 106. That'll end up in the numerator with this sine. And then we're gonna apply a sine inverse to both sides. So as we apply the sine inverse to both sides, on the left-hand side, we'll just get C. On the right-hand side, we actually have to figure out what is sine inverse of this. All right, you may be saying, okay, no big deal. I got C is supposed to be 32.2 degrees. But that turns out being a little bit of a problem in our situation. All right, if C, this angle at the top, is supposed to be 32.2 degrees, that means that B is gonna be the very biggest angle. All right, the calculation would be, they always have to add up to 180. So that would mean that B is equal to 180 degrees minus the 32.2 degrees that we just came up with minus the 11.6 degrees. That's gonna be a problem because that will be our largest angle. So 180 minus 32.2 minus 11.6 gives us 136.2 degrees. Based on our triangle up here, if that's gonna be the very largest by a significant amount, 136.2, it should be opposite the very largest side length. 11.6 is gonna be the smallest, it's across from the smallest side length, but the biggest side length is this 106. So really, angle C should be the very largest. All right, so in this case, because we used law of sines and the sine inverse, that kind of created an incorrect angle for C. This would not happen if we use the law of cosines and did the same process that we did up here. All right, however, what we can do is we can correct this by using that as a reference angle in the second quadrant. So the 32.2 degrees, if we use that as a reference angle in the second quadrant, we can calculate the angle that wraps around here and lands into the second quadrant by using 180 degrees minus the 32.2 degrees, which works out to be 147.8. So I'm going to go ahead and cross this out and say we're using this as a reference angle into the second quadrant. So angle C is going to be 147.8 degrees. 147.8 degrees. All right, what remains is we still need to find angle B. So angle B can be calculated by taking 180 minus, we said C was 147.8, minus angle A that we calculated up above is 11.6 degrees. So angle B works out to be 20.6 degrees. All right, and double checking, when we take a look at our triangle, we have the smallest angle across from the smallest side length, the middle angle across from the middle side length, and the largest angle across from the largest side length. When you get going on this, law of sines can be a little bit tricky in that whenever you apply a sine inverse to both sides, like what we did here, what can happen is this is sort of like the ambiguous case as far as law of sines goes, that either it could be this angle that works, kind of double check with your side lengths to make sure it makes sense, or you can use that as a reference angle into the second quadrant and do 180 minus that reference angle like we did over here to get our angle C. If you avoid the law of sines and you strictly use the law of cosines here, you're not gonna get this reference angle coming out. It'll always give you the correct angle. All right, so I know this can be a tricky problem. Hope this helps out in doing our calculations and solving a triangle where you're given all three side lengths. All right, good luck.